Barstoolers, welcome back to Hamlet's Barstool. Today, men, we have a great topic for you today. If you haven't been here before, hello, my name is Josh. I am a certified patron of the arts, and with me today we have Josh, Jaden, Brody, and today we have a very special guest, a woman. And let's see if she has anything to add to this conversation today.
Hi, I'm Dr. Caroline Ellis. I'm a professor in English literature at Oxford University. I have a PhD in linguistics as well as humanities, and I'm translating a new version of Beowulf right now. Thank you so much for having me.
Okay, well, so getting into today, our topics for the day will be Act 2 to Act 3, essentially one of the very important parts of this podcast, which is, in fact, the room analysis, the character analysis, as well as the style analysis. So, starting, men, what do we think about this opening scene to Act 2? We are found with Ophelia. Loki, she's kind of fine. Loki?
I'm sorry, did you just say that you think that Ophelia was attractive? I don't think that's very relevant to this discussion, but...
Oh my gosh, did you just... Bro! What? That's cute. Yeah, no. I think beginning of Act 2, like, low-key, when Ophelia, like, comes in and then is, like, scared and is, like, talking to Polonius, she's, like, all, oh, no, Hamlet, he, like, came in and he was scary and just, like, looked at me weird and stuff. I don't want to hear it. Honestly, least favorite character out of all of these people. I mean, Ophelia's just, like, low-key there. Like, we get it. She wears flowers. She does all this. Well, one thing I do think is really interesting about her, like, the only interesting thing about her, is how much her clothes contrast with everything else on the set. Like, when she's coming up at the beginning, everything is just painted so dark all throughout this production of Hamlet. Everything's so dark and dismal. And then... while Hamlet, when he's kind of out of the color palette of black and suit and ties and stuff, he's more trying to act out and insane. Whereas Ophelia doesn't fit in because she's not really supposed to fit in. She's supposed to be naive. She wears all these flowers. She comes off as more childish. Whereas Hamlet is trying to come off as erratic and crazy. And while his outfit looks childish, it's for a different reason. So, yeah.
Yeah, no, I think it's super important, especially in this version of Hamlet,
right,
that he,
right? His mental state is essentially kind of like, I love the orange t-shirts. I think it really shows off his, it shows off kind of as a facade, because it's like a, it's a muscular t-shirt, which is him trying to be strong and command this, like, effort that he wants to kill the king and he has to be strong to do that, but it's really just a t-shirt. And also I think orange is a great color choice for this piece because he comes out wearing a t-shirt and jeans and he looks out of place. I mean, man, would you want to show up to your wife's Tupperware party looking like this? No, you would look out of place. She would send you back to your room and have you change.
Holds Tupperware parties. Are those still a thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, I do think that is really interesting, going off of, like, Hamlet's motives with his crazy outfits.
One thing we haven't mentioned yet is his hair. At the very top of the play, slicked down, you know, looks like he works in finance, works on Wall Street, very put together. And he also just, the whole show, he looks just gaunt and pale and looks like he's seen a ghost. But then once he actually does see the ghost, he starts acting crazy. His hair, you know, even when he's in suits, from the second that he talks about he needs to pretend to be crazy so no one can figure out his plan, his hair is crazy. It's all, you know, while it's not like growing out and he has shag, he's still clean shaven. His hair is spiffed out. He's got gel in it.
got that Old Spice pomade in it, but, like, bro, this is not the look. He's looking a little bit more wild, but not absolutely insane.
Real. Jaden, do you have anything to say on this? You've been kind of quiet.
No.
Okay. And, what's your name again? Sorry.
Yeah, sorry, I did also forget your name. What is it?
Totally forgot.
It's Caroline.
Right. Okay. What do you think about this?
Yeah, no, I think at the end of Act 3, another thing that y'all haven't mentioned yet is throughout the story, there's a use of, or especially this adaptation of Hamlet, there's a use of mirrors. Towards the end of Act 3, he kills Polonius and he shatters that mirror. So I think that reflective aspect does represent, like, struggle. Like, it's, like, tension. Anywhere there's, like, mirrors, tension is starting to crack. He's starting to crack. He's starting to mentally decline. I think there's a lot of mirrors and reflection. It shows tension in relationships. There's tension between Gertrude and Hamlet. There's tension between Hamlet and himself, especially with the feeling of he wants to just be king, but he's not. There's a internal conflict of he isn't at that position right now, but he wants to be.
Yeah, and I really don't think that you can appreciate the actual madness of Hamlet without actually reading the play. So I have pulled up lines 75 to 85 from Act 3, Scene 4, and I chopped it up a little bit, but. Have you eyes? Could you on this fair mountain mm-hmm. leave to feed and batten this moor? Mm-hmm. Ha! Have you eyes? You cannot call it love, for at your age the heyday in the blood is tame. Mm-hmm. It's humble and waits upon the judgment. And what judgment would step from this to this? Since you have else, could you not have motion? But sure that sense is apoplexed. Yeah. For madness would not err. Nor sense to ecstasy was never so thralled, but it reserved some quantity of choice. And also, I have a little clip from one of my friends at medium.com where they write that Shakespeare wrote madness because of devastating losses in the characters' lives, meaning that trauma, shock, or mischance might affect their sanity. In addition to this, he also wrote the madness and excessive of unrequited love. So for Hamlet, it was madness over the loss of his father. For Ophelia, later on in this play, she dies because she is just so heartbroken because of her father's death.
Well, men and woman, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I forget. What's your name again? Cheryl. Right. Well, thank you, Christine, for coming on the show with us today. I think it really adds perspective to this super serious, dense
topic. Is this a sports talk podcast?
The sports season's over. There's nothing going on right now.
Well, I mean, you can still talk about sports if it's the off season. I mean, like,
yeah, but like, are we gonna do that? No, we gotta find something to do.
I thought we were going to have a productive conversation, but okay.
All right, man. Barstoolers, rate us 5 stars on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, whatever the heck else there is. Y'all subscribe to us on YouTube. We got a YouTube channel going. Barstoolers, you can also check us out on our courses, Hamlet's Barstool University. All right, men, let's go get some beers. Bye, Barstoolers.